Well, I'm here with Ann Patchett, my friend from Nashville.
Yeah.
We just both had keynote speeches here at the ABA Winter Institute for all the booksellers that were here. It was fantastic and a lot of fun, high energy and lots of different ideas. But you have certainly had a left-hand turn in your career. You've been this prolific author, and I hadn't realized the depth of all of your writing for magazines before this morning.
Yeah.
But now you're also a owner of an independent bookstore, Parnassus. And in some ways, you've become quite a spokesman for the independent bookstores all over the world. How did that happen?
That was the biggest surprise. And when I sat down and thought I want to open a bookstore, it was really just because we both live in Nashville. There wasn't a bookstore. There needed to be one. Someone had to do it. No one was doing it. Okay, I'll do it. I never thought of the larger context of opening the store, and I really have found myself as the almost evangelical spokesperson for independent bookstores. Because I'm a writer and I have a higher profile, a lot of people wanted to cover the store, and again I found myself in this role, and I'm loving it.
Well, you certainly have had enough experience in the bookstores for a number of years, and I found it interesting. Take us back to the earliest days of your very first book and going into the bookstore, and I'm sure it's just a little bit different today. Draw a little contrast for us of what it was like then.
It was crazy, and I don't think this kind of book tour exists anymore, but they told me I had a budget of $3,000. I went to 28 cities. I went in my car every place. I had a publicist who was sending me to Cleveland one day and New Jersey the next day and Atlanta the next day because she, I guess, had failed American geography in eighth grade. It was such a huge amount of work, and every store I went to, there was no one there because no one had ever heard of me. And they said the point was to go in and make friends with the girl behind the cash register in hopes that she would read the book and then after I left would hand sell it. And quite the strategy. But what's so amazing is now that I have a bookstore, I really understand the truth of it. And after that talk that I just gave, I had a lot of young women come up to me and say, I am the young girl behind the cash register, and you're right. I am the one who's selling your book, and if I love your book, I'm going to hand sell it. And they felt very appreciated to be noticed. But yes, at some point the story changed, and all of a sudden I had huge crowds, and the sales were the sales that we had that night while I was in the store. But you can't underestimate the value of getting to know your local independent bookseller.
Now you're an independent bookseller. How much time do you spend in the store?
I do not spend much time in the store. I come in about every 3 days. I'm there for a couple of hours. Mostly what I do is sign copies of my own book and shelve them. And then I walk around the store, talk to people, recommend books. I've been very clear from the start of this whole idea that my job is to write the books. My job is not to hand them to you and check you out. And while it may be fun to have your author gift wrap your book, I think everybody understands my time is better spent at home writing books.
We need you writing anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
We would like to read the next
book.
But
I did pay for the bookstore, and I am promoting it. And so I've had a big part in it, but I don't think that my part is like an everyday walking around sweeping the floor kind of thing.
Well, I know you, and having talked to you before, you have this also amazing giftedness to look at a cover and know what's in the book and whether it's good or not.
That's right.
And next year, I'm going to have to consult you when I do the best book covers of the year, which I did a few weeks ago, because you're really good at seeing what's the content beneath that book. So do you rush around and grab people and say, no, not this one, or you better think about this one when you're in the store? Or do they have to hold you back from doing that?
No, I do that. I definitely give books to people all the time. If I see somebody with a book, oh, you like this book? You like Train Dreams by Dennis Johnson? Then you might really like this other very short novel, The All of It by Jeanette Haine. And if I see somebody who has, say, a David Foster Wallace novel and a Jeff Eugenides novel and The Bridges of Madison County, and I will say, you know, you might want to put The Bridges of Madison County back, because if you're up to these two books, that might not be the book for you.
Not a best fit.
Yes. I think that it's not only a good thing to give books to people, but it's also a good thing to take them away sometimes.
That's not the usual sales approach, right, to take the books away, but you're building that community and
exactly.
the trust. Exactly.
So. The community of trust. That will be our tagline.
That's very good. Well, I want to just touch on this last book, State of Wonder, which is a great book, which I read, and I won't go into the details of the book, but I'd love to know the setting, and how did you get the richness of that setting? Did you travel there?
The book is set in the Amazon, starts off in the frozen dead of winter in Minnesota, and then goes almost immediately to the tropics in the jungle. And I did go. I wanted to do some research. I felt like I could have done a lot of it just making things up. That's what I do. I make things up. But it was great to go. And it's so oppressive and claustrophobic in the jungle. And for 3 days, I thought it was the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen in my life. And by the end of the week, I was going out of my mind. And I would have sold my mother to get out of there. So that was great. I was really glad to have had that full experience.
Well, now that we're here in New Orleans, is the next book going to be set here somewhere?
Where I travel is the next a lot. Book? I don't actually write a book about every place I go.
Where is the next book? Give us a hint. What is where or what is it?
The next book.
Have you had time with the bookstore opening?
Well, yeah. The next book, I hesitate to even say this. It's a book of essays, which I feel is a little bit like saying I'm writing a book about cruel work in the 1800s. It's not anything that makes you think, wow, that's really going to sell. But I have had a huge career writing nonfiction, doing magazine work, writing essays, writing pieces for anthologies. And strangely enough, some of my best writing is this nonfiction. So I am putting that together, and then after that, another novel.
Well, you've had this very interesting work in magazines, the bridal, all these things.
I've gone from Bridal Guide to the New York Times.
It's all there.
It's, everything is there.
Tell us a little bit about some of that experience. How did you work your way through all of that and find yourself? How did your career progress through these magazines?
You know, it was all about money. It is all about money. I wanted to be a novelist, and I'm very serious and very pure about my fiction. I never sell a book before I finish writing it. I don't take an advance. I write entirely what I want to write, but I needed to pay the rent. So I taught college for a while. That was extremely time-consuming, and I suddenly realized I could write a stupid article about shoes. I could make more in 2 hours than I could make in a month of teaching, and then I could go back and write fiction. So I started off at 17 Magazine when I was 21, and I wrote for them until I was 30, and then just went through all the different magazines. I did Fashion, I did Elle and Glamour and Vogue, and then slowly progressed to smarter and smarter magazines. Started writing for the Washington Post, started writing for the New York Times Magazine, for the Atlantic, for Harper's. I just grew up, but I still write trash every now and then.
So will you intermingle the trash with the
The trash is trash. It's not sort of colorful, endearing trash. It's things like surviving a breakup, how to decorate your locker when the chemistry isn't there.
Okay, interesting.
When your sister gets a horse and you don't, those sorts of articles.
What do you do?
We just need to forget them.
Well, thank you very much. This is great. A friend from Nashville in the world of books. And book selling, and all of your books have been terrific bestsellers, and it's amazing to see sales.
Not all of them.
Not all of them. But it's amazing to see sales even for books as people still are discovering you, and that's the beautiful thing about having such a body of work. And so congratulations on
Thank
that.
You.
It was great to speak with you here at Winter Institute and to have a keynote before you, which I was delighted to do. And it's such a pleasure. And perhaps as we flew down here together, we may find ourselves on the plane back together, I'm not sure. So thank you very much.
Thank you for doing this. I appreciate it.